was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name. Sin was heavy, the chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you called me,
you for connecting. We're in this series that's all about Bible prophecy. And today we're looking at the Battle of Armageddon. It's something that, of course, has been in popular culture for a long time, but it comes directly from the book of Revelation, from God's word, the Battle of Armageddon. So what is it all about? What does it mean? Well, I have to say that this message tonight is not for the faint of heart. Because the Battle of Armageddon is the most gruesome battle. It will be the greatest conflict that will ever have been fought on this planet. The whole armies of the world coming at each other. but it will be the final battle. And that's the great news. It may be gruesome, but it's great news because it is the final battle. It will be the final battle of the final war. And there'll be no more war because Jesus Christ will defeat evil and Satan once and for all. And all injustice will be taken care of. And all evil will be done away with once and for all. And Christ will set up his kingdom here on this earth. So it's exciting to learn about this. But I think it's also important to understand that this is in Scripture for a reason. Even though I truly believe that Scripture points to that Christ followers won't be here in the tribulation, it's important because the rapture will come. And Christ will take us home to be with him, but we will be with him at the second coming as he comes back to set up his rule and reign upon this earth in the new heaven and the new earth. And it's really important to see how it all ends and what it's all heading toward, because everything looks like it's out of control right now. I mean, the whole world, it seems to be in chaos, but it's really not, because it's all leading up to a crescendo and God is still in control and it's all part of God's plan. And it's leading up to the big ending. And so that's why we study it, because it's so important to know that we win in the end. Now, some people say, well, it's important to know that we win in the end, but the book of Revelation is just all about symbols. It doesn't really mean anything. All it means is that we win in the end. And if that were the case, then why didn't God just say, hey, we win in the end, so don't worry about it? And no, there are a lot of symbols in the book of Revelation, but those symbols represent real events and people and things that are going to take place in the future. And so it's important to study it so that we'll know how to live today, because we can live victoriously, we can live triumphantly in the middle of problems and difficulties, because we know that God has overcome. And one day, he'll claim his rightful place on this earth, because he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So let me just do a little recap here with a order of events, basically. I hesitate to call it a timeline because we don't know when these future events will take place. And by the way, there are those out there that get a little crazy with the book of Revelation. And they start saying, well, you know, this symbol means exactly this, or the Antichrist is going to be this person, and they'll name names, and they'll say this is going to happen in this year, the rapture is going to take place, you know, 7 years from now or whatever, and they'll put a date on it. And they'll just get down to every little detail, and I think that's pretty crazy. Because the Bible says not even the Son knows the day or the hour that he'll be returning. And that's because the Father is going to tell him when it's time. And Jesus has chosen not to know. And if someone predicts, well, I know this date and that date, and this is going to happen then, this is going to happen then, you know, through the book of Revelation, then I just don't trust them at all. But I do think there are some things that we can say from the book of Revelation that are in general terms that we can say, hey, this is what this is going to be like. This is what is going to happen here. We may not know exactly when it's going to happen. We don't know exactly what it's going to look like, but we can know in general terms what's going to happen. And God wanted us to know that. And that's why he spent so much of the New Testament and so much of the Word of God with prophecy so that we can know. And so let's look at it again. Starts with, of course, creation. I may need to get another. Here, let me try this. Starts with creation. That's a little better. And then we have the fall. So Adam and Eve sin in the Garden of Eden, the fall of man, and we need redemption. And that's why Christ was born in a manger, and he came to us, lived a perfect life. He died, rose again, defeated sin and death. So that was Christ's first coming right here. And then when he ascended back to heaven, everything from then on is what is called the church age. Or the last days. And so we said before that people say are we living in the last days? Yes, we're living in the last days for the last 2,000 years. We just don't know if it's the very last part of the last days. And there will be the last part of the last days, and then the rapture will take place, where Jesus Christ comes in the clouds, and he will be like the magnet, the great magnet that will draw us who have the metal of the Holy Spirit in us as Christ followers who are alive, will be raised up to meet him, caught up, is what the Bible says. And that's where we get the word rapture from, a great catching up in the air, and we'll meet Christ in the air. It'll be a great disappearance because it won't be seen by others, only the Christ followers. It'll be instantly taken up to meet Jesus as he comes back. Then right after the rapture is the 7 years of tribulation. Now again, some scholars believe that Christ, the rapture, is going to take place after the tribulation or in the middle of the tribulation, but I believe the Bible points to before, though no one knows for sure. But we talked last week about all the reasons why it looks like Scripture points to that the rapture takes place right before the tribulation. But we do know there'll be 7 years of great tribulation, and the Bible says it'll be the worst of the worst of the worst times, and it describes terrible wrath being poured out on evil and on all those who are going against God. And so then, after the 7 years of tribulation, then you have Armageddon, the great battle. Hope you can see that, but what happens is the 7 years of tribulation ends, and the last judgment is the great battle, the Battle of Armageddon, where the world's armies will gather together as they rise up against Israel, and they rise up against God and try to defy God, and the great battle of Armageddon will take place right here. But here's the great thing. Second coming of Christ ends the Battle of Armageddon. The Scripture says that the second coming of Christ ends the Battle of Armageddon. And so Christ comes down and he defeats all evil, the world's armies, and then he sets up his millennial reign. I haven't spelled that, but you get it. The millennial reign of Christ. The thousand-year reign where we come to reign with him here on this earth. And he creates a new heaven and a new earth. And so the Battle of Armageddon takes place right there at the end of the tribulation. Christ comes back and he wins and he claims his rightful victory and sets up his kingdom upon this earth with a new heaven and the new earth. So I wanted just to remember that picture. I don't know if you can read it or not, but I want you to remember that picture. Because that's the sequence and the order of events and the way they happen. Well, let's look at this passage in Revelation 1:7, our key passage. This describes the second coming of Christ. You see, there was the rapture, and then there's the second coming of Christ. And so it says in Revelation 1:7, "Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen." And so there are two phases of Christ's return, the rapture and the second coming. Those are the two phases of Christ's return. Jesus Christ is coming back. Jesus Christ is returning. The King is returning. There will be the return of the King. That is for sure. But Scripture teaches that there are two phases of this return. There's the rapture, and in the rapture, he comes, and it's like a great disappearance. All the Christ followers are caught up to meet him. Everyone wonders where the Christians went as they're taken out. There'll be all kinds of theories for it, of course, but it'd be a great disappearance. But in the second coming of Christ, everyone sees him. Even the enemies see him because he comes down to win the victory against all evil. He comes down to set up his kingdom upon this earth and claim his victory that he's already won at the cross. And so that's the two really phases of the return of Christ, the rapture and the second coming. And a lot of times we get the two confused. So let's look at Revelation 16:12, because the Battle of Armageddon and the second coming all go hand in hand. It says in Revelation 16, 12, then the sixth angel poured out the bowl, his bowl, on the great Euphrates River, and it dried up so that the kings from the east could march their armies toward the west without hindrance. And I saw three evil spirits that looked like frogs leap from the mouths of the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. They are demonic spirits who work miracles and go out to all the rulers of the world to gather them for battle against the Lord on that great judgment day of God the Almighty. Look, I will come as unexpectedly as a thief. Blessed are all who are watching for me, who keep their clothing ready so they will not have to walk around naked and ashamed. And the demonic spirits gathered all the rulers and their armies to a place with the Hebrew name Armageddon. And so here we see that the great battle takes place, the battle of Armageddon, and Christ returns, the second coming of Christ, to win the battle. Now, I want you to see seven things about the second coming of Christ. Seven things about this battle of Armageddon, the last battle. First, the battle of Armageddon is better understood as a campaign that extends over the last half of the tribulation period. And so the battle of Armageddon, instead of thinking of it just as a single battle, the Greek word in Revelation 16, 14 for battle is polemos, and it signifies a war or a campaign. And so the events that culminate in this great gathering at Armageddon, at the second coming of Christ, are really viewed by God as one connected campaign. And this war that will start during the tribulation and culminate there as the armies of the world gather, this one world army gathers to try to defeat Israel and God's chosen. But I want you to see a second thing. The location of the campaign is in the Valley of Megiddo. I've been there several times. I've had the privilege of being there and looking out over from Mount Carmel onto the Valley of Megiddo. It's west of the Jordan River in north central Palestine. It's some 10 miles south of Nazareth and 15 miles inland from the Mediterranean Sea coast. It was a place where many of Israel's battles took place. It's been a battlefield all throughout history, this Valley of Megiddo, because there are a lot of things that just converge there. And of course, as we know, Israel is this place of convergence where, you know, the Middle East, where East and West comes together. But the location is in the Valley of Megiddo. Now, the word Megiddo in the Hebrew is gadad, which means to be cut off or slaughtered. And Armageddon means the Mount of Megiddo. Armageddon, Mount of Megiddo. And so this Valley of Megiddo is where the battle will take place, because all these armies will gather right here to go against tiny Israel. In Revelation 14, it says, the blood from the lives slain at the Battle of Armageddon will flow for 180 miles, 4 feet deep. 180 miles long and 4 feet deep. It'd be like a river of blood because of all those slain at this last great battle. The biggest battle in the history of the world, in a world that's known a lot of war, a world that's known a lot of conflict, a world that's known a lot of death and injustice. But at the very end, it'll be the most gruesome and awful battle, but it will be the end of all evil. And so the third thing that I want you to see is the events leading up to the Battle of Armageddon are described in Revelation chapter 5 through chapter 19. And it's a series of divine judgments that are on the earth during the Great Tribulation. And so the Battle of Armageddon is really just the last judgment on humankind and evil and those who have opposed Christ and chosen to rise up against him. And so the Great Tribulation is 7 years, and it goes on for 7 years. And so this is just the last judgment, the Battle of Armageddon, as these judgments or wraths of God are being poured out upon the world and evil. And I want you to see the fourth thing, the rise of a world dictator called the Antichrist in Revelation chapter 13. And so somewhere in the Great Tribulation, things are so bad and people are looking for a savior. And this person will rise up and this person will look great and everybody will say, oh man, how brilliant. They've got all the answers, you know. And it'll be a world dictator called the Antichrist in Revelation chapter 13. We're introduced to the Antichrist. And so he will rise up during the great tribulation. Is the Antichrist already on this earth? Well, we don't know, because we don't know when the rapture is going to take place and when the great tribulation will take place. He very well could be on this earth already and rising up to prominence and power, but he will rise up to take over in the great tribulation, as everyone will be willing to give up any of their freedoms so that they can have total protection, because everything will be so bad. There'll be so much killing and so much pain and problems and famine and plague and all these things that will happen in the great tribulation. In Revelation 13, 7, and in verse 8, 7 and 8 and 16 and 18, it says, he was given authority to rule over every tribe and people and language and nation, and all the people who belong to this world worship the beast. He required everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to be given a mark on the right hand or on the forehead. And no one could buy or sell anything without that mark, which was either the name of the beast or the number representing his name. Wisdom is needed here. Let the one with understanding solve the meaning of the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. And so it's saying that the Antichrist, or the beast, is the symbol of the Antichrist in Revelation. This beast, the Antichrist, this man, will usher in a one-world government, be given authority to rule the world. It'll be all those now that desire that one-world government. You know, if everybody was under the same umbrella, it'll all be great, and we'll all be taken care of. But eventually, that's what the world will go to during the tribulation, because everything will be so bad. People say, hey, we need this one-world government, straighten everything out, and this guy's amazing. And at first, he will be amazing. He'll do so many things that'll be good, compassionate, kind, and everyone will look and say, wow, this guy's unbelievable. He is the Savior. He's saving us. And so he'll set up a one-world government. He'll set up a cashless society, a one-world economic system. And a few years ago, when pastors would talk about this in the book of Revelation, people would say, that's nuts, a cashless society. And of course, now no one thinks twice about it. But it'll be a one-world economic system. And unless you join this one-world economic system, then you won't be able to buy or sell anything. You won't be able to get food. You won't be able to have a business or have commerce, because it'll all be totally controlled by the one-world economic system, which will seem harmless at first in this cashless society. And everyone will be required to take the mark of the beast to be involved in this cashless economic system. And the mark of the beast, we always think of people getting a huge red 666 on their forehead, you know? And that's not the way it'll be. That's a symbol. See, the number 666 are a symbol, because in heaven, or in the Bible, the perfect number is seven. The perfect number, or the number seven, represents perfection in the Bible, in the symbol of numbers. And so six represents that number that misses the mark. It's the number of sin. It's the number of falling short. It's that number that is never perfect and always sinful. So 666 means it'll be compounded. And so it doesn't mean the number 666 will be painted on people's foreheads. In fact, it could be three six-digit numbers, like a Social Security number, that could be implanted with a microchip in someone's forehead or in someone's hand. And I can't even imagine how small that they could make something like that now, that you just, when you go into a place, you know, it just registers your three six digits so that you're able to access your bank account and all of your finances and all of your records. And so, and without that, then you can't do anything, basically. And so that's one way that he will be able to control everyone. And then, of course, he'll make everyone worship him. Everything will be great at first, and then he'll say, you've got to worship me, and he'll destroy and try to kill all those that choose not to worship him, because it'll be said, well, it's just for the good of everyone else. And so we got to get rid of all the troublemakers in this very troubled time. And so that's what the scripture is really clear on, all these things. When they will happen, who knows? And, you know, there are a lot of people that get really crazy about this stuff. You know, it's like, I'm not going to get a computer because, you know, it's controlled by the beast and all those crazy things like that. No, I mean, you know, it can be used for good or evil. That's the way everything is. You know, computers, computer systems, you know, a cashless society can be used for good or evil. It's, to me, it's all about using it for God's glory and God's good, because before Christ returns, before the rapture occurs, we as a church are supposed to get everyone in the lifeboat that we can. And so we're going to use every means that we can, because the Holy Spirit wants us to reach out to everyone to tell them the good news that Jesus Christ is the Savior. And there's only one Savior, no human being, it's Jesus Christ. And he can save us and rescue us and protect us and guide us and give us his peace. And so we want to let everyone know. And we're so blessed that we are in this era of technology. And yes, it will be perverted in the tribulation, without a doubt, and used for evil. But it doesn't mean it's evil. They're evil people, but there's no evil computers. I mean, computers today and all the internet and everything can be used for evil right now. There's so much evil on the internet, you know, with pornography and violence and all kinds of things and abuse. And yet there's so many great things. It's all how you use it. The good news of Jesus Christ is getting out more than ever. And I want you to see something positive that happens in the Great Tribulation. Revelation chapter 14 foretells a final global evangelistic appeal that will happen in the 7 years of the Great Tribulation. It says in Revelation 14, 6, "And I saw another angel flying through the sky, carrying the eternal good news to proclaim to the people who belong to this world, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. Fear God," he shouted. "Give glory to him, for the time has come when he will sit as judge. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all the springs of water." So as the Christ followers are raptured out before the tribulation starts, there will be, I believe, many that will turn to Christ too during the time of tribulation. They'll say, "Hey, what my relative said is right. Jesus came back and took them, and we need to turn to Christ." And there'll be some who turn to Christ during this time, and they'll reject the Antichrist, and they'll be persecuted and some killed and some martyred. And it talks about them in the book of Revelation. But the amazing thing is, in the middle of all the evil that will be taking place, God still sends the good news out all over the world to let everyone know that, hey, there's still time to lift up Christ. There's still time to worship him. There's still time to put your faith in him and trust in him. He's getting ready to sit on his throne of judgment, and he's Lord of lords and King of kings. And so there's still time for you to make him King of kings and Lord of lords in your own life and be saved for eternity. And it just shows me the grace and mercy of God. And if it wasn't for God's grace and mercy, then none of us have a hope. We're all lost causes and hopeless cases without God's grace and mercy. But because of God's grace and mercy, if you've received Christ, you're just a trophy of grace. That's why we don't judge others. We can point out sin. We can point out injustice. But we want everyone to come to Christ, because without him, there is no hope, but we have him, and we're all trophies of his grace. We can't brag or boast, but we can thank him for his mercy and for his grace. But Revelation 14 foretells God will give one more chance, one more chance, one more chance. He keeps giving one more chance, one more chance. And then the sixth thing I want you to see is Revelation 18 predicts the ultimate collapse of the world system, described metaphorically in Revelation as Babylon. And those who are tied to the world system will lose everything when it collapses. And so many, it's another grace and mercy of God, that God will allow all that to collapse so they'll give people that one more chance to see all that they're trusting in is not going to save them. That it never works when you trust in things that rust. They're not eternal. And so all those things that aren't eternal will be just wiped off the slate instantly. And people will lose everything that are tied to this world system. But then the seventh thing, the most important thing, Jesus Christ returns to the earth to claim his victory at Armageddon. And so you see that there'll be the 7 years of tribulation. The Antichrist will rise, and then he will take the world's armies and lead the world's armies, as the world's armies will unite and go against tiny Israel because they're holding out. And so they'll go against them, and they'll meet in the Valley of Megiddo, and there will be the last battle. The battle lines have been drawn. The greatest confrontation and conflict in the history of the world is about to begin, and the beast, or the Antichrist, and the false prophets have gathered all the governments of the world, the armies of earth, under the Antichrist rule, and they come against Israel. Now, the enemy armies believe that they're there under their own volition, that they've made the decision to do this, but that's not true. God has drawn them there so that he can defeat them. God has drawn them there. It was all part of God's plan. It looked like everything was out of control, but it's all part of God's plan. That's what's going to happen in the Great Tribulation. God has summoned them there in order to defeat them. But there's no fight, really. I mean, yeah, it's a fight. Evil's defeated. The Antichrist is thrown into the lake of fire. It's a fight. The blood runs 4 feet deep. But it's no fight, really, because God Almighty and his son, Jesus Christ, he comes back and boom, it's over. Because he's not coming back to win the battle. He's not coming back to win the war. He's already won the war when he died and defeated sin and he rose again and defeated death. He won the victory. We live in victorious times in the middle of all the pain and difficulties and evil and all the stuff that is so wrong. And we experience bad things and hard things, but we're triumphant because we're on the winning side. Christ has already won the battle. He's already won the war. He just comes down to claim his victory in the Battle of Armageddon. He's in control. He draws the armies of the earth together for his own purposes so that he can win the final battle. And he throws the Antichrist and all of the false prophets and leaders are captured and sent to their punishment into the lake of fire. Now, I want you to notice the contrast in Revelation chapter 19, describing this, Jesus coming back, the return of Christ, winning the battle of Armageddon and defeating evil once and for all. The contrast between his first coming, when he came the first time, he was a tiny baby in a little manger, born to peasants in a filthy animal stable, the most humble way the God Almighty could have ever come to this earth. But the second coming is going to be a lot different than the first coming. In Revelation 19, 11, it says, "Then I saw heaven opened, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flames of fire, and on his head were many crowns. A name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure white linen, followed him on white horses. From his mouth came a sharp sword to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron rod. He will release the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, like juice flowing from a winepress. On his robe at his thigh was written this title, King of all kings and Lord of all lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, shouting to the vultures flying high in the sky, come, gather together for the great banquet God has prepared. Come and eat the flesh of kings, generals, and strong warriors, of horses and their riders, and of all humanity, both free and slave, small and great. Then I saw the beast and the kings of the world and their armies gathered together to fight against the one sitting on the horse and his army. And the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who did mighty miracles on behalf of the beast, miracles that deceived all who had accepted the mark of the beast and who worshiped his statue. Both the beast and his false prophet were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. Their entire army was killed by the sharp sword that came from the mouth of the one riding the white horse, and the vultures all gorged themselves on the dead bodies." It's a little different in the second coming. He comes back as reigning King of kings and Lord of lords to put all injustice aside for good and to destroy all evil. He comes riding on a white horse. His eyes were like flames of fire, and on his head were many crowns. Crown him with many crowns, for he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I want you to take this away with you from this study and what we're looking at. First, the drama of all this unfolding, all these unfolding events is spectacular, it's gruesome, but there's nothing to fear when you're on the winning side. If you're on the winning side, if you're a Christ follower, if you've accepted Christ, there's nothing to fear. If you haven't accepted Christ, there's a lot to fear. So we don't have to be afraid of anything. When we die, we get to go to heaven in this perfect place. The last thing that my dad said coherently to me was, to live is Christ and to die is gain. When he went to be with the Lord this last month at 84 years of age. You see, to live is Christ and to die is gain. And And, you know, we pray for the Lord to leave us here on this earth to make a difference, and that's great and glorious, but heaven is even more glorious, and so you don't have to be afraid of death. But if you're not a Christ follower, you ought to be afraid during these difficult days. There's a lot to fear if you're not a Christ follower. 365 times, the Bible says the phrase, fear not or do not be afraid. It's as if God is saying, that's one for each day of the year. There's not one day that you have to be fearful. When difficult things happen, when pain hits and tragedies occur, when injustice comes into our lives, we don't have to be afraid because God still has a plan. God still has a purpose. You don't have to be afraid, God says. This is a time to release your fears, to renew your faith, and to get on your knees to fight. But if you don't know Christ, it's time to receive him right now. You can just pray right now and say, Jesus Christ, you're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I give up. I need you. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. I accept your free gift of salvation. I want to be a trophy of your grace. You want to get it settled during these times because could Christ come back tonight? Yes. The rapture could be tonight. It could be 10 years from now. It could be 2 months from now. It could be, we don't know. We need to be ready. The scripture tells us to be ready. And then it also reassures us that good will triumph over evil. You see, we're on the winning side if you're a Christ follower. Romans 8:1 says, there's therefore now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. It means all our guilt is forgiven. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve to be on the winning side, but Christ took our place on the cross, so we're on the winning side. But also, good will triumph over evil. All evil will be destroyed, and praise God for that. So thankful for that. All the injustice in the world today, all the injustice that's ever been committed, God's going to come in and destroy it all, the last battle. No more abuse. No more racism. No more of the sacrificing of unborn babies in the name of convenience. No more evil. No more murder. No more hate. And praise God, I think about the young African-American man who was jogging and he was murdered and because of the color of his skin. There'll be no more injustice. There'll be no more racism. God's coming back to destroy it all. There will be no more selfishness and sin. And here's the thing. Praise God for his grace that's still available to every sinner. Still available to every sinner. But I'm so grateful that one day all the evil, all the injustice, all the abuse, Christ is going to set up his kingdom and say, no more. I let you have your free will. I let you choose your own way. And this is what happened. But no more. And he will tolerate it no more. And evil will be done away with. And that gives me such encouragement to know when you see things that you just can't explain, that evil looks like it's triumphing, that no, God's going to have the last word. God's going to have the last say. And it gives us hope as we face difficult times. I mean, when you think about you're on the winning team, it gives you hope today because that's what it's all about. We're studying this not because of tomorrow, but because of today. Because we want to live victoriously today in the middle of the difficulties and the injustice. We want to live victoriously today. It's hope because there's a hope named Jesus Christ. Hope has a name. His name is Jesus Christ. And I love how it says in verse 13, he wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. He's the King of all kings and Lord of all lords. And I think about that because the scripture tells us clearly that Jesus is the Word. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God at creation, and the Word was God. And then it says the Word became flesh, and he dwelt among us in that first coming. And the Word is returning. You see, the Word of God is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ revealed to us. And the reason we study the Bible is not so that we can learn more. It's so we can get closer to Jesus, because Jesus is the Word. The Bible is totally true, divinely inspired. But don't miss who the Word is. As you study the Word is not an it. The Word is a person, Jesus Christ. And He's all through the Word because He is the Word. From Genesis to Revelation. And the whole purpose of life is to lift up the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And as you read Scripture, you see where Jesus shows up in every single book. It's amazing to see. In Genesis, He's the light of the world, the creator of all things. In Exodus, He's the Passover lamb that redeems His people. In Leviticus, He is the high priest that bridges the gap between God and imperfect man. In Numbers, He's the cloud and the fire that leads His people into the promised land. In Deuteronomy, He's the prevailing prophet. In Joshua, He's the captain of our salvation. In Judges, He is the eternal judge of both the living and the dead. In Ruth, He's the kinsman redeemer who rescues the lost and the lonely. In 1 and 2 Samuel, He's the voice of truth in the middle of a dark night. In 1 and 2 Kings, He is the one true king. In 1 and 2 Chronicles, He is the holy one. In Ezra, He's the faithful one. In Nehemiah, He's the rebuilder of broken walls. In Esther, He is the rescuer in our time of need. In Job, He's the restorer of all things new. And in Psalms, He is the good shepherd. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, He's the wisdom of God. In the Song of Solomon, He's the banner of unconditional love that hovers over us. In Isaiah, He's the suffering servant. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, He is the God whose heart breaks when our heart is broken. In Ezekiel, He is the resurrection of life for dry bones. In Daniel, He's the Son of Man coming in the clouds. In Hosea, He is the bridegroom who never stops loving the bride. In Joel, He is salvation. In Amos, He is the burden bearer. In Obadiah, He is the mighty Savior. In Jonah, He's the God of the second chance. In Micah, He is the messenger of good news. In Nahum, He's the restorer of justice. In Habakkuk, He's the interceder for the broken. In Zephaniah, He is help for the helpless. In Haggai, He's the cleansing fountain. And in Zechariah, He is the pierced Son of God. In Malachi, He's the Son of Righteousness. In Matthew, He is the Messiah. In Mark, He's the miracle worker. In Luke, He's the Son of Man. In John, He's the Son of God. And in Acts, He's the power of God. In Romans, He's the gift of salvation. In 1 and 2 Corinthians, He is the last Adam who reversed the curse. In Galatians, He is freedom. In Ephesians, He's the cornerstone that the builders rejected, but He's now become the chief cornerstone upon which all life is built. In Philippians, He is the name above all names. In Colossians, He is the fullness of God. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, He's the peace of God. In 1 and 2 Timothy, He's the great mediator between God and man. In Titus, He is our blessed hope. In Philemon, He's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. In Hebrews, He is the blood that can wash away all the stains of sin. In James, He is the great physician. In 1 and 2 Peter, He's the great shepherd. In 1, 2, and 3 John, He is everlasting love. And in Revelation, He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He is the blessed Passover Lamb of God that is unblemished. He is the Lion of Judah. He is Jesus Christ, King of all kings and Lord of all lords. And that is who we serve, the King of kings. And one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So why not do it now? Do it now. And receive His grace, because we've all sinned. We've all messed up. We're all broken. But we can be trophies of His grace. You can receive His free gift of salvation. Just pray, Jesus Christ, I need You to forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. Thank You that You are the King of kings and Lord of lords. Be the King of my heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, now we're at the part of our service where we give back to God. And we always give you an opportunity to trust Christ and always give you an opportunity to give, because that's a huge part of worship. So as you give, thank God for all that He's given you, because it's all Jesus. And as you give, thank Him for all these ministries and missions that we're doing, because Woodlands Church, the Word is getting out. And the Word of God is Jesus Christ. And we lift up the Word of God and we lift up Jesus Christ above all. And people are coming toward Him. People are coming to know Him. As we're not just telling people, but we're being Jesus to people by feeding people, by clothing people, by doing all the things that we're doing. in our community and around the world. And so I just encourage you to give. WC.org/give. WC.org/give. And you give online. If you haven't done it yet, get set up. You can do it. Just set it up. WC.org/give. Or you can do it on your smartphone. And you just text the word give WC, one word, to 77977. 77977. Give WC. And as you do that, you can set up recurrent giving there as well. Or you can mail your check into One Fellowship Drive, the Woodlands, Texas, 77384. One Fellowship Drive, the Woodlands, Texas, 77384. I just really encourage you, be Jesus to someone. Join the ministries and missions that we're doing now. We're just stepping out in faith like crazy because we have Jesus Christ, the antidote. Jesus Christ is the antidote to man's sins, the virus of sin, and we have it. And we're going to lift up the light in the darkness so people will be drawn to the light and the love of Jesus Christ. So let's give to him because it's in Christ alone that we trust. Lord, bless our giving. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and when strife cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, the fullness of God in helpless pain, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Light of the world by darkness slain, but then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine. Bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to its final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell and no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Power of Christ, I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
God bless you, Woodlands Church. In Christ alone, we stand. Chris is going to ask some questions that you've been sending in. And so thank you for your questions. I'll try to answer them best I can. If I don't know them, I'll just say I don't. And we'll look at it and study it for next week. So, Chris, what do you got?
Yeah, the first one's good. It's really, when Jesus comes back, his second coming, is it too late for them people to receive him if that moment's already happened? Can they still receive him after that moment?
Yeah. After the rapture, I really believe after the rapture, not the second coming, but the rapture, during the 7 years of tribulation, the scripture points to people coming to know Christ, choosing to come to know Christ. And it says that most of them are martyred. They become martyrs. So they're really choosing to die and go to heaven or to live under the mark of the beast and, you know, and try to keep living the world system. And that's what most people do, keep living the world system, because it'll mean that it means pretty much certain death if you come to Christ in the great tribulation, because you won't be able to take the mark of the beast. You won't have any food. They'll try to track you down, all those kind of things. So the point is, come to Christ now. But after, when Christ returns in the Battle of Armageddon, no, the scripture is real clear on it that no, after that happens, we see nothing in scripture where people have a chance then to receive Christ. It says every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord, but they'll admit it, but they won't have made him Lord of their life. It'll be too late at that time. And so here's the real thing that's even more important, Chris, is that you can only come to Christ when the Holy Spirit draws you. And so sometimes people say to me, well, I'll come to Christ at the end of my life when I'm in my 80s or whatever and I can't party anymore and have a good time, you know, and sin like I want. But right now I'm living it up. But one day I'll just pray and receive Jesus. No, you won't either, because you can only come to Christ when the Holy Spirit draws you. And if the Holy Spirit knocks on the door of your heart and you don't open it, then that next time he knocks, it could be a softer knock until finally there comes a time when the Holy Spirit stops knocking and you can't trust Christ after that. You can't come to Christ. If you're worried that maybe he stopped knocking on the door of your heart, then that means he's still knocking, but he's knocking right now on the door of your heart. And if you haven't received him, you need to do it right now, because that's all we know we have is now. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Now is the time of God's favor. So just ask Jesus right now. Just maybe kneel down where you're at or just pray this prayer. Jesus Christ, I give up to you to be the king of my life as best as I know how, and I need you to change me from the inside out. Forgive me of my sins and take over. Be the Lord of my life. Good question, Chris.
All right. This is a good one. This is coming kind of as a clarifying question about the rapture. And it says in Romans, Paul actually says that the Jews have the truth hidden from them so that the Gentiles can receive the gospel. And I think we're kind of still in that season where we're all receiving it, right? So then it says, what do you think, or what are your thoughts on the Jews being left essentially as Christians are raptured? A lot of people say, who's going to tell people about Jesus when the Christians are all raptured? Well, a lot of people would then say, well, the Jews, the truth will be told to them. So what are your thoughts on that, and how does that fit into kind of what we've
been talking
about?
That's a great point. I really believe that God, even though the Jewish people have rejected Christ, I really believe that God still has a special anointing on them, that they're still God's chosen people, but yet now we're also God's chosen people. All those who come to Christ, we are the children of God, all those who come to Christ. But yet there's still something there. And I do believe scripture is real clear. There'll be a great coming to Christ and seeing that Jesus is the Messiah for the Jewish people. And I think it's important to just, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, to pray for Israel, to pray, because God says, I'll bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And so I think that's really important. But I do believe the scripture says in Revelation, there are 144,000 evangelists that will go throughout the world and bring lots of people to Christ during that great tribulation. And it doesn't say who they are, but it implies to me that there'll be Jews who realize that the Messiah, there'll be completed Jews that realize that Jesus is the Messiah. And that he is the one, and they'll be amazing evangelists. And I think that's what scripture is saying there. So, and there's, it doesn't say for sure, but the scripture does tell us there's going to be a great coming to Christ from the Jewish people at the end.
That's good. Yeah, what this is a question. I'm going to just
go for
serve
it.
You up. Here you go.
Go for it. I'll just I'll just say what I don't
happens,
know if I don't.
What happens when we die? So
yes.
Do we technically just arrive in heaven? Do we fall asleep? And kind of what does that look like?
Yeah, that's a great question because Chris and I have been talking about that from Scripture. And so you take Scripture in context, and the Bible says to be absent, to be absent from the body means to be present with the Lord. And so as soon as, and remember the thief on the cross, he looked to Jesus and said, remember me when you get to heaven today. And he said, today you'll be with me in heaven. And so as soon as we die, our spirit, who we really are, goes directly to be with God in heaven, the Bible says. There's no such thing as a soul sleep where, you know, we're asleep until the rapture. And then we get raised up with God, but we didn't realize it because we were in a soul sleep. And some people, you know, have taught that. But no, I really believe that the Bible says as soon as we die, if you're a Christ follower, you go immediately to be with him in heaven. But the rapture, it talks about the dead in Christ will rise first, and then all those who are left alive will go up to meet him instantly in the air. That, I believe, and most scholars believe, that's talking about our resurrected bodies, that you will be in heaven. Your spirit, who you really are, is going to be in heaven. Then you will get a resurrected body when the rapture takes place. And the resurrected body will be like Jesus' body after he rose from the dead. He could eat fish. He could, you know, he had a body, but it was a resurrected, perfect body. He still chose to have the scars to show how much he loved us, so we'd remember that. But he had a resurrected body. And so I don't understand it completely. And that's for sure. There's a lot. I don't understand a lot about it. But I know that the scripture says we'll be directly in heaven with him. And it also says that we'll get our resurrected body to join our spirit when the dead in Christ shall rise first. And people then ask, well, will people be able to recognize us in heaven if we're just this spirit blob? No, you won't be a spirit blob. You'll be recognizable. It's just this resurrected body that Scripture talks about that we don't completely understand. But that's a really good question. And the main thing is just make sure you know Jesus so you'll be in heaven with him and tell everybody about him. Thank you, Chris. Those are great questions. Yep. I think that's about it. Hey, God bless you, Woodlands Church. Let me speak that blessing over you again that we've been speaking. That's the Aaronic blessing, and it's from Scripture in Numbers, and it's all about God telling Moses to tell Aaron, the high priest, and his sons, the Levitical priesthood, to say this blessing over the people, and when you do, God says, I will join you and bless them. And so now we're the priests of God. After Christ died, rose again, he's in our life. We don't have to go to a priest to get salvation or forgiveness of our sins. We go directly to God. He says, you are the priesthood of the believer. And so we speak this blessing over you, Woodlands Church. And the blessing is a powerful blessing where God says, or where Moses and Aaron says the blessing. I bless you, and the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine on you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and be gracious to you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, Woodlands Church, claim that for you and your family in Jesus' name. God bless you, Woodlands Church. We love you. We'll see you this weekend.